The majority of my work with alcohol inks has been limited to dropping color on a surface, usually Yupo, and either letting the drops bloom or manipulating them with a stirrer or straw. Today I'm moving away from drops as the background and will be using a brush, canned air, and gravity to move the colors of ink. As you'll see, the look and outcome of each background is different depending on the application method. Once the background is set, I'll show you some very basic options for adding texture and color. I'm going to show you three techniques today for getting color on Yupo in a way that's quite different from what I've done in the past when it's mostly been drops and either allowing them to bloom or maybe manipulating the drops a little bit but really maintaining that drop. So the first one, and you see an example of it here, is to put alcohol down, put the inks on it, and then use canned air to move the color around and manipulate it. The second one is going to be a kind of a drippage thing, which most of us have done on a journal page or something, but it really does allow gravity to do the work for you. And then the third one is going to be putting alcohol ink down and using a brush to manipulate it. So everything you know about alcohol ink on Yupo remains when you're using these techniques. Nothing changes, it's just kind of a different application method. So the first thing you want to do is avoid touching the face of the Yupo with your fingers. Handle it by the edges as much as possible. That'll keep any of the oils on your fingers from getting on the surface, which can act like a resist. And then the blooming thing, it happens. When you put a color down, it's going to bloom. Whether it's a dot or it's a stripe or it's just a big old splash, until that solvent base evaporates, the color is going to move and it's going to spread. Now you can control that to a certain extent by blowing on it. The harder you blow on it, the more quickly that solvent base evaporates and you get less movement and less blooming. And as you play with this and you blow on your little droplets and things that you've got going on, you'll see what I mean by that. So this is a piece of 11 by 14 medium weight white Yupo. I'm going to work on something a little bit smaller, so I'm going to drop down to a piece. Again, this is the same mid-weight stuff. This one just happens to be 9 by 12. So the first step here is going to be to take some alcohol and put it on the background. This is going to allow you to have more or less puddles of color that you can then use that spray can of air to manipulate. So I have three colors. I have lemonade, I have pink sherbet, and I have wild plum. I'm not going to use a ton of color because you really don't need to for this. And you'll see what happens as this all starts to move. All right, so here comes the wild plum, which is quite a bit brighter. Maybe put a little bit there. So there's no alcohol here, but you can see the blooming. That doesn't happen when this hits the alcohol, when the inks hit the alcohol, but it's certainly, it's all going to blend together anyway. So this is the wrong can of air. Let me grab this one, which is a newer one. I want to spray, you're just basically going to see the nozzle come in. I want to use very little air, and now I'm talking. Ordinarily I would have started to move this, so this may not turn out exactly the way that I had planned, but I need to tell you as I show you, and so don't expect fabulous results, I guess is what I'm saying. You don't want a big blast of air because it's going to cause spitting, so get comfortable with the can of air that you're using and figure out how you can just get little bits of color like this, little bits of air like this, and you still sometimes do get a little bit of spitting, but you can see how you can move this. Now different kinds, different brands of canned air move a little bit differently, and in fact I'm not real happy with that can, so I'm going to switch back off to this other one, which is a little bit easier to control. And so I'm using the air to do two things. The first thing it's doing is helping that alcohol and the solvent base evaporate off, and then the very obvious thing that it's doing is allowing me to move the colors around. Now how you do this is entirely up to you. You can swirl them all together, you can leave them in discrete areas. It depends on the day. Sometimes it seems like when I do it, you almost never know what's going to happen, and that's the thing with alcohol ink. You have to give up a certain amount of control with it because it's going to do what it wants to do, and sometimes no matter what you think you're trying to fix it, it just won't. Now the other thing you need to be aware of is that these cans of air are meant to be held upright and sprayed. So some of the time you're going to see propellant come out at the same time. I just think of that as serendipity. It's impossible to control. If you have an air compressor, like an airbrush, then you can use that, and obviously then the propellant is not an issue at all. So again, I'll apologize, this is not very pretty, but you can see the process and how this works. And if I want to come back and add color, I can do that. If I want to come back and, you know what, let's just turn this whole thing. If I want to come back and add color, or if I want to come back and add more alcohol, I can certainly do that. But you can see how you can gently manipulate this color and move it to go where you want it to go. It's more just a question of getting comfortable with the can of air and then the technique so that you get this color kind of moving where you want it. So I don't like the way that that looks. I think what I'm going to do is find, because I dropped it on the ink where the on the Yupo where there was no alcohol, I'm not real fond of the way that that looks, and I don't know if I can fix that, but this is part of the way that you learn as you play. You realize, well, okay, I probably don't want to do that again. All right, so I can kind of move some of that around. Now, if I want to get extreme, and this is how you oftentimes will see people do what look like flower petals. You get this kind of ruffling thing that goes on with air that works really well on Yupo. Or you can simply move it around like you saw me do earlier, and you can get that color to kind of go where you want it to, as much as you can control it, because as I said, this stuff does really have a mind of its own. But this is how you do this, and you work this around and you play. Now I'm going to just get this out of the way for 1 second. This is, as you know, my workbench is covered with the nonstick craft sheet, but this is a separate piece. What I find that happens is I tend to be very rough on my surface because I'm here working all of the time, but I don't mind getting color on here. What I mind is when I can't get the color off. As you start to work into your nonstick craft sheet, there are going to be times when you get little abrasions or things that are on there. None of that affects its non-stickability, but it will, in my case, it becomes distracting because my surface becomes colored or messy. So I'm just working on one of the pre-cut 15, I think it is, by 18 inch pieces so that I can move that out of the way and still have a clean surface to work on afterward. The dripping technique really relies on gravity to get the color to move, but it's also helped along by the addition of either some blending solution or some of the isopropyl alcohol. Now, I don't have an eyedropper nearby, and I also find that constantly dipping the eyedropper into alcohol and sucking some up in there and then squeezing it out onto the piece, I find that a little bit aggravating. For that, for this particular technique, I like the blending solution. There's a needle tip on the bottom of my bottle. I can get the stuff where I need it, and I don't have to monkey with it. So what I'm going to do is put down a piece of paper towel, because this particular method uses a fair amount of liquid, and this is just going to catch it and keep it from being an absolute mess on my work surface. I've got three colors. I've gone back to the pink sherbet and the wild plum, but this time I'm introducing some of the honeycomb in there too. So I'm going to start by putting color along the top, whoops, along the top here. Gravity's doing its thing. You can see the colors are moving. Let me come in with some other here. Now, the thing to bear in mind is that both alcohol ink and blending solution are a lightener. When you add them to color, it's definitely going to make them lighter. So you can see that I've got some interesting stripy things going here. And if you wanted to, you could call this done, and you could come in and maybe doodle in these areas in here, or you could work on this in a way that utilizes the white space that's left. But if you're thinking you don't want to do this, then the option is to come back and start adding some more color. And then you can also start with the blending solution. And as I said, this is going to lighten. So you see what happens here. You get, it starts to blend the colors. And again, I'm just tipping the extra ink off onto that paper towel. It starts to blend the colors and move them and lighten them. And it really creates a really interesting kind of streaky thing that happens here. Now, if you want, you can turn this way, and you can start your movement in the other direction and see what happens there. So now you have this kind of original group of colors striping one way, and you've got this wonderful patterning that happens as you go the other. So again, I'm just going to tip off that excess ink, and since I'm working this way now, I'm going to continue to work this way. I'm going to come back with some of the pink, and I think I'm going to drop in some more of the honeycomb. And I'm just going to let that run. Now, if this is not, for some reason, I must have gotten my fingers on here. I'm just touching that with my nail to try to cover that area. If I don't like the way that this looks, I can come in and put some blending solution on. Now, this one I've played with probably a little bit too much, although there's some nice areas and patterns forming now. I might actually call this done and leave it alone. So the thing that's important is to stand this up and to allow all that extra color to drip off, because if you don't, as it dries, it's going to actually run back into your design, and it'll dry in a it's hard to explain, but if you see it, you'll know it. It dries in this kind of ridge. So what I think is interesting here, and though everybody says you can reuse Yupo, you just wipe your color off, and that is true, but what happens is, see the original stripes of color? There's a certain amount of staining that happens that is unavoidable, but the thing that's cool is it's there in the background. So if I, again, if I see what happens is this starts to run back this way, so I would turn this like this and start utilizing what's going on here and picking these other colors up. And if I think, and this is really overblended, I would never have done as much as I did here, but I'm just trying to show you options for working with these colors. If I want to come in and start adding a little bit more color, I can. I can move it along with the blending solution, and I already can, I think this is better because there's some actual pattern that's developing as opposed to just those kind of wild blobs of color. So once you get that done, and just bear with me one second while I wipe my hands off and I slide this out of the way, you have some options, and we'll talk about those after the next segment, but you have some options for what you want to do. So this piece was done with the dripping technique, and as you can see, when you don't overdo it the way that I did to try to demo the technique for you, you get some really beautiful results, and you can start to work through those areas and define them using dots and alcohol and brush marks and all different really interesting kinds of things. So the last thing, I'm going to come back in a moment and I'll show you how to do to use a brush to manipulate fairly large areas of color. I have some brushes that are strictly dedicated to working with alcohol ink. I don't mess with them with anything else. Could I? Probably, but I've just chosen to leave these four, and that's all that I use them for. So you can see that I've got some different shapes. I've got a round, a little bit smaller round, a liner brush, which I use a lot to make dots, and this is just a smaller round brush. You can use whatever you want, whatever works for you. Whether you dedicate them to alcohol ink or not, of course, is up to you. So another piece of white medium weight Yupo. This is 5x7, and all I'm going to do is put some stripes on the paper and then move it around with the largest of my brushes. So I have lettuce and I have pool. Whoops, I'm just going to put some color down. Now the one thing that you'll do, and actually that I should have done a moment ago, is put a little bit of alcohol in some kind of a container. This is a cap to one of the ink sprays, and I'm just going to need some color in here, some alcohol ink in there rather, so that I can use it to rinse my brush out if I need to. All right, so, and in fact that had some dried alcohol ink in it. So now all I'm doing is just moving the color around, and as I said, the things that you know, you can see the bloom happening, you can see that edge that's starting to creep there. This is what alcohol ink does. The technique doesn't change the properties of the product. Now I'm going to rinse, I'm actually going to wipe this off just on a piece of paper towel because I don't want to necessarily change the color of that turquoise too much. It's going to blend to a certain extent anyway. I'm going to put a narrow band in here again and just go ahead and move it. Again, it's doing its thing. I'm going to wipe the turquoise off and come back with some green. Now I think I'm going to do a little bit wider area of green here. And I can do that a couple of ways. I can either put down more color, or I can take some color and stretch it and thin it and move it over a wider area like this. When I stretch it like this, obviously I affect how much that color is going to move. Let's get some of this on. I'm going to wipe off most of that green and just come back to the turquoise. So all of those things that you're accustomed to happening are still happening. I'm still getting color movement, and I'm still getting blooming, and you can see those things, the traveling that's going on here. Just going to kind of spread that. I'll wipe the most of that turquoise off, and then just come back with a little bit of the green. Now, even though I've put straight lines on here, you can see that what I'm getting is far from straight lines. And that's interesting, and that's, again, where you have to sort of give up a certain amount of control with alcohol ink, because it's going to do what it wants to do. So I've got some of that pooling that happens at the edge, which I can either live with, or I can come in with a piece of paper towel and just pick up a little bit by running it along here like this. And then that color will kind of flow back out toward the edge. Now, if I think that this has gotten to be too green, that's easy enough to solve. I can come back in with some of the turquoise. And I can either manipulate it with a brush like this, or I can just put it on there and let it do its thing. But the minute you start adding color over the top, when you put one color on another, it pushes it away. So you need to recognize that that's what's going to happen when I put this on here. then it starts to get interesting, and you can think, well, all right, well, what do I want to do next? Do I want to create some darker areas like this where the color has moved, or do I want to come in and put some drops on? And for the one that I had a moment ago that I just can't find, these larger areas were drops of color that I put on there. The little dots we'll talk about in a second, but that's exactly how that works. Now, you don't have to wait for this to dry to do that. So I can come in here. Actually, you know what? Let's pick a different color. I know there's a lighter color someplace here. There's a bottle of aqua if I could put my hands on it. All right, well, I can't, so let's come in. We'll use some willow, which is kind of an in-between green. And I think I'm going to put a drop right here and kind of take advantage of that thing that's already going on. And you can see that the color gets pushed out. You get that dark ring that forms. And this is very typical of when you do this, when you put one color of alcohol ink, when you drop it on another, or you just put some on top of another. So I want a bigger one there. So I'm going to put two drops rather than just the one, and we'll see what happens. And then because things look good in threes, I'm going to put one more drop right there. So I get these design elements that start to form. I have these areas of color movement that I can work with, and then I have the circles that bloom, and again, this is the unpredictable nature. You can see how completely different this is blooming. I'm getting all these really interesting ruffles. Now, if I had tried for ruffles, probably wouldn't have gotten them, but this is what happens. And so you can play like this. If I wanted to, I could take, let's pick a color here. I really am determined to find that aqua because it's the color that I'm really looking for to do what I want to do, but I'll be darned. It was here and now it's not. So what I could do is take a color, and let's come back to the pool maybe. And this is my bottle of pool. The top is off. I'm just going to throw some color at this and see what happens. And so now I get this interesting thing that happens, completely serendipitous, but boy, do I like that. I don't know if I could ever duplicate it, but you get these really interesting designs that happen completely unpredictably, but that's part of what makes alcohol ink so wonderful. So you can let this dry, and then you can come back and you can start to work on it in ways other than just adding more color. Now for me, that typically means I'm going to come back to this liner brush, and I'm going to use just straight alcohol to create these dotting kind of things. And I'm going to take a moment to show you that in the next, and which will be the last segment. Once you have your pattern, your background, your design, whatever it is that's on your Yupo, some sort of an abstract something or other, or maybe not, but whatever that is, and you decide that you want to add to it, one of the ways that I do that with a brush is just with straight alcohol, which is what I've got in here. It's the 91%. This is the liner brush you saw from the last segment. Now, like anything with alcohol ink, the more of the thing that you put down, whether it's the more of a color, the more the blending solution, or the more of the alcohol, the bigger the reaction is going to be. So this liner brush, this, as I said, is just the 91% alcohol. If I pick up a lot of alcohol on here, and you can see that droplet on the end, and I put that down, I'm going to get a big spot and a big bloom. If I don't dip the brush back into the alcohol and I touch it again, you see that I'm going to get a smaller one because I've already taken some of the ink, the alcohol off. If I dip it a third time, I'm going to get a still smaller one, and I can continue to do that because as the amount of alcohol on that brush decreases because I continue to touch it, I'm going to get smaller and smaller and smaller resultant dots. Now, rather than have to continue to keep touching that off like this, you can start off with considerably less alcohol on your brush to begin with. But you can see the effect there, how I go from big, so big that these actually ran together, to progressively smaller ones. So the way to do this is to work with less to begin with. So I can dip the brush in the alcohol, and then I can wipe a lot of it off so that I'm left with just a very little amount. And you can see how I can play with that now and get much smaller dots. And I can keep my dots a little bit more or less consistent, knowing that I can get maybe 5 or 6 taps and get the same size dot resulting, even though there's less alcohol, because I might press the bristles just a little bit more to get a little bit more alcohol on there. And as you play with this, you'll learn the way that that works. So for example, if I want to, and again, I'm going to knock most of this off. If I want to come along here and I want to put some really tiny dots, The way to do that is to start with very little alcohol on the brush to begin with. How close you place them is a function of how much alcohol is on there. If you put them too close, the way that I did here, you're going to find that they're going to run into one another. Now the interesting thing is, you can go back and put alcohol where there already was some. So if I come in here and I touch, you'll see that I can get a circle that blooms inside the circle. Now it's not real obvious, but it's definitely there. If I want to take a little bit more color and come back and do this in here, I can, and you can see the pattern begin to form as the alcohol blooms. So you're not limited to putting alcohol once, and you're certainly not limited to doing this only with alcohol. So for example, if I wanted to come in and I'm just going to grab some of the pool. Now you can do this on a little palette. You can just pick up, I'm going to use a paper towel and just wipe the alcohol off. You can do this any number of ways. I'm just going to put a little bit here for now. So if I wanted to work with turquoise and put turquoise dots down, it's a simple matter of using turquoise alcohol ink instead of alcohol and applying it that way. And just as with the alcohol, how much of the product you have on the bristles and how big a dot of it you end up with is a function of how much you get on there to begin with. And then the fun stuff is that if I wanted to come back and do this, I can. And so I can create an entirely different look by starting to layer these colors on here. And can I come back and touch this with some plain alcohol? Absolutely, I can do that. So that you can see that with one single brush, and depending on how much of the alcohol or how much of the alcohol ink you get on there, you can change up what happens. Now, if I want to get really extreme, and I want to, I'm going to have to put a fair amount down here to get enough in these bristles to puddle. If I want bigger dots, it's just a matter of, well, I need to get some more on here. There's not enough because this is a big brush. It's just a matter of getting enough on those bristles so that you can come in and dot it. Now, this brush is not in particularly good shape, which is why I'm getting some irregular stuff, but you can see that there are a multitude of ways to play with brushes once you get your background on to come in and to add some detail. So whether you use all three techniques, you combine them, you use one consistently because you like it, I guess the important thing to take away from today is that there are a lot of ways to get color and pattern on alcohol ink that have nothing to do with putting drops on to begin with.